see those two numbers in parentheses as a shorthand, as community of love shorthand, that just means that we're going to emphasize verses 29 and 30. So you look for the book of Isaiah in the Old Testament, and as you find Isaiah, you look for chapter 30, and then you put your finger around verse 18 and 33, and then we're going to emphasize 29 and 30. Now y'all know how to do it around here. Let your Bible close up, and you have it on your digital device, and then fire it out for a second, because I want to set this up for you. You know, set it up for you. So you come into the Word of God, and it makes sense for you. For the month of February, we're singing every Sunday, lift every voice and sing. And one says, well, the Bible just sing the same text every Sunday in February. Well, it's a potent and powerful text, that one that we don't know that well. We want to emphasize that even during Black History Month, that this text is a gift from the African American experience to the world. That oftentimes we try to say that this is our story, this is our narrative. And within the African American culture, we have actually done the opposite. We've given it to the world. So here is something that's a gift from our pain, from our struggle. This is something that we want to have you to use, to empower you, to inspire you, so that it's not so much us and ours, and you and yours, but it's a we thing. From the struggle, we bring the commonality. The one thing that we all understand from the human life is that all human beings struggle. We all go through challenges and situations that oftentimes seem to distance us from one another. But it's in our struggle that we actually reach commonality. It's in our struggles that we actually see that we're not in solitude. And so as much as our struggles make us feel like we're the only ones struggling and we're the only ones going through, the reality is if you have the courage to tell your struggle, if you have the courage to have a testimony, tell your testimony. Whether it's through a testimony, through a song, through a poem, through a text, through a speech, whatever it is, that you will find out that your struggle can be empowering and inspiring to others who are struggling. We have a tendency to struggle, and I've said this many times before. We'll go to our room and we'll climb up in our bed and we'll close all the shades and pull the sheets over our head and lock the door and just spoil ourselves in the fetal position. And as much as it seems to temporarily feel good, it robs us of the fellowship of those who love us. It's in those times where the fellowship of those who love us becomes tested, because the question is that when you're down at your worst, will they still think that you're fun enough to be around? Come on, somebody. When you don't feel like laughing, will they still come and embrace you and do all the things that you usually do? Or will they say, oh, she's a bore, he's a bore right now, let's go find something else to hang out with? Or, more importantly, as your folks, who you love, find themselves in precarious and challenging situations, and you go. You're the rock in the relationship. You're the one who prays in the relationship. You're the one who brings the situations to help you. You bring food. You bring resources. You bring cheer. You send the text messages with the emojis. You send all the things that folks need, but when it's your turn, it's a reciprocal. We have a tendency to give up on one another in the worst times possible. And so here's a song that comes out of 1900. Comes out of this Reconstruction moment that says to the world, Here. So for the month of February, we're going to look at this song not as our scripture, because we know that the Word of God is the authoritative voice, but as inspiration to see what the gift is. If the premise is that the song is a gift, then we need to go in the song, interpret it, and delve in to figure out what the gift is. Let me show you something just from the what we call literary analysis. Today we're going to deal with the first verse, just the first verse. Lift every voice and sing, till earth and heaven ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening sky. Let it resound loud as the rolling seas. Sing a song full of faith that the dark past has taught us, sing a song full of hope that the present has brought us, facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on to victory. This one, let me show you this. This first verse is praise, but it's aspirational. It is praise, but it's aspirational. It is a sing until. Sing until these things occur. It doesn't say sing until you feel like you're done singing. It says sing until, right? Lift every voice and sing till we, the vernacular for until, right? Lift, now check this out. Lift every voice and sing. Not just every black voice, but every voice and sing. Sing until. Now we begin it. Until earth and heaven ring. What kind of ring? Ring on the harmonies of liberty. Now, how should that singing sound? Like the rejoicing. Rise. High as the listening skies. Let it lift up off the earth. Let it resound loud as the rolling seas. Right? And then it says, sing song, this number two, full of In the book of Isaiah, chapter 30, we're reminded of the rebellious children of Israel, these folks in the area of Judah, who were facing some really, really big challenges. The people of Assyria had fledged war on the children of Israel. And the children of Israel had decided that instead of being faithful to God, instead of waiting on God, instead of standing still and allowing God to fight their battle, they would create an alliance with Egypt. And together, the people of God, the children of Israel, the Jews, would create an alliance with Egypt, and together they would take out the Assyrian army. Now, God didn't tell them to do that. They did that on their own. And so as a result of them not having the patience to rely on God, as a result of them not having the humility to know that God is God all by himself, they created this alliance under Hezekiah. So now, because of the alliance, the children of Israel are moving from the area of region of Judah down to Egypt. Because if they say, we're going to be in alliance with them, we should be able to go down and find some safety. And when they get to Egypt, they start looking for the prophets. They start looking for the prophetic voices of God, and they're not finding them. And so they're wondering, did God leave them? That they're looking for churches, they're looking for
sets out to sound with the go to the mountain of the Lord, to the rock of Israel. And the Lord will cause his majestic voice to be heard, and the descending blow of his arm to be seen, and furious anger, and the flame of the fiery fire, with a cloudburst and storm of hailstones. The Assyrians will be terror-stricken at the voice of the Lord, when he strikes with his rod, and every stroke of the appointed staff that the Lord lays on them will be to the sound of tambourines and lyres. Battling with brandished arm, he will fight with them, for a burning place has long been prepared. Indeed, for the king it is ready, its pyre made deep by the fire, and wood in abundance. The breath of the Lord, like a stream of sulfur, I've said this before. Game of Thrones and scandal ain't got nothing on the Bible. The Bible got mad plot, y'all. The Bible got it. It's in the Bible. It's graphic. I mean, it's there. But what I want you to see in verse 27, that God is angry. Remember I told you before that as a young child in the church that we were always taught that anger was a sin. Should never be angry. And that was bad teaching. It was bad theological teaching because God gets angry. God is angry. The scripture says, be ye angry, but don't allow your anger to create sin. But anger is a real emotion. And some of us actually need to get angry about some of the things that are going on. We need to have that kind of sense of just, oh! The way that describes God is sometimes how we should respond to some of these things that are going on in the world. So God is angry. But verse 29 says that the people will have a song. And the people sing. And as the people sing, they need to keep singing and keep singing and keep singing until the majestic voice of the Lord joins in the song. See, don't miss that. The people have to sing unto God until God joins the song. And as God joins the song, it says that all these things would occur, not because the people were fighting, but because the people were singing. And as they sing, God will do the work. And it says,
some of us lip-sync, praise God, I do. Oh, somebody hear me today.
That's why we have a community of love, because we want to
want to accept God's challenge to learn how to love Him. It takes time. It takes patience. And sometimes we get it wrong. But we pray that the love that you have for us will avail the opportunity for us to apologize when we step on your foot. And you give me a big